children, and don't let them fall by the side of the road. And teach them to love one another, that heaven might find a place in their hearts. 'Cause Jesus is love. He won't let you down. And I know got to walk on through temptation, 'cause His love and His wisdom will be our helping hand. I know the truth and His word will be our salvation. Lift up our hearts to be thankful and glad that Jesus is love. He won't let you down. My soul, Jesus is
he would have told us. He said, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back again and receive you unto myself. So that where I am, there ye may also be. Those are very comforting words coming from our Lord Jesus Christ. And I sure hope that they are comforting enough for each and every one of us here about Job going home to be with the Lord. Amen. Until later in this service, when I will come back with the eulogy, you are in the capital hands of the church mother of this church, the district missionary of this district, Mother Adela Hens. Put your hands together for her as she comes.
I'm on my way to heaven.
Dear God, our Father, we thank you for this day. We know, dear God, that you are a God that knows all things. And you said in your word, dear God, that all things work together for good
know that even now, during this time of bereavement, when we think about Brother Joe's life and how you extended it, that life, and how he had such a fruitful life, and how his life touched so many other lives. So, dear God, we just thank you for him. And God, we ask that you will look upon the family. Just bless them now to look upon you and to trust in you and to realize without a doubt that you are God that will take them through even this time of bereavement. In the name of Jesus, comfort them, uphold them, bless them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.
I will be reading 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 1 through 8. For we know that if our earthly house in this tabernacle were dissolved, we have a building of God, and house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For in this we groan earnestly, desiring to be clothed upon with our house which is from heaven. If so be that they clothe, we shall not be found naked. For we that are in this tabernacle do groan, being burdened, not for that we would be unclothed, but clothed upon, that mortality might be swallowed up of life. Now he that hath brought us for the same self things of God is God, who also hath given unto us the earnest of the Spirit. Therefore we are always confident, knowing that whilst we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. We are confident, I say, and willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord.
Yeah.
but humble to many, and joy like the dad some didn't have. A father leaving his children to carry on his line. A husband honoring the vows made to the one whom he loved, till death do we part. She's now left with a vacancy in her heart. A grandma who left stories to be told by his grandchildren and family, entrusted with gold. A great-grandfather not able to share his memories or love that some now cherish. The blessing, no, the privilege for him to be so old. Gone, not soon to be forgotten. You ran your race. You stood the test. As God saw it best, go on and take your rest. We're really going to miss you. Hope you're on the journey.
He would beat a rascal. We'd be in the kitchen.
He would have lied to go back there where he's cooking, though. Don't get in there, boy, because he liked to grab that hatchet. I remember one time he was cooking some gumbo, some shrimp, some gumbo with seafood in it. I don't eat seafood. He had this big old long crab sitting in a bowl. And I told Joe, I don't eat that. Oh, boy, you don't eat that food. Eat that food that I told you to eat. I said, but Joe, I don't eat that food. I don't eat that. Man, you don't eat that. I told you, I cooked it for you. Eat it, eat it. That's all I can remember. But I tried to eat as best I can. I was looking at that big old long piece of crab, and I was like, okay, Joe, I won't eat it, man. But that's all I can remember. And every time I would see him, even the last time we saw him before here, we always have a smile for us. And I tell you, he remembered all of us by name. He called us out, me, Gordon, Jock, all of us back in the days, and even up until now. And Sister Ann, I tell you, we're going to hold our hands up high for you as well, because I love that man like he was my own little father, too. Amen. God bless you.
Okay, where's Karen? Where's Sharon? were very small children. Our children grew up together. There's my daughter over there, Linda. They grew up with Gray. And the rest of them, hallelujah. But we have been friends for many, many years. And you know, we told each other just about everything. You don't tell your friend everything, but you tell them just about everything. I didn't know Joe, but I knew her personally very well, very fine. And we used to cook. We used to cook every Sunday over there at that church. I mean, big meals, dressing, grains, macaroni and cheese, peach and cobbler, the rolls. I mean, Brother Joe was throw down in there. By himself in there with a couple of more cooks, but he was the main cook. And every Sunday we used to come. You know, y'all, he looked mean. You know, he was scared to say something to him. You know, because he had that look. You know, you know, we used to, me and my cousin, when we was coming, you know, we didn't have money or nothing, because it was me, like I say, the kids and her kids, and it was a lot. So we was like, we didn't ever have money to go get no dinner. And Pastor Vicky used to be like, why y'all ain't over there get something to eat? We was like, well, Pastor, we ain't got no money. Well, go over there, tell Brother Joe, I sent y'all over there and tell him to get y'all, feed y'all. And we was like, okay. You know, so we'll go over there and we'll be like, what y'all want? We'll be like, we want such stuff for Pastor say for you to give us a plan.
Ain't nobody told me nothing. Ain't nobody told me nothing.
You know, we like, well, Pastor told us to come over here. You know, I ain't got no money. I ain't got no money. So we had to go back. Pastor, Brother Joe, and we ain't getting it. Our money. So we'll go over there, give them the money, then come again Sunday. We go again. They ain't got no money again. Pastor again. Tell Brother Joe, Pastor, Brother Joe, we went over there last Sunday. We ain't going over there again. We ain't get the two of them. You said we had to come back and get the money from them. So he'll give it to us. So we'll go over there, Brother Joe.
Y'all got some money. Y'all got some money. Like, Brother Joe, we got the money. We got the money. I'm fool, but
man, he was a sweet man in heart. We got to know him, you know. But then, gonna miss them dinner rolls. Oh, man, throw down on them rolls. What's a good cook? He was a good cook. I ain't never met nobody like that. He was still trying to cook, even though he got up. He still was trying to cook whatever he can. You know, I guess he wanted us to know he still got it. And he still did. You know. We don't take that, you know, we don't miss him. Sister Lee, did he leave the recipe? Man, did he leave the recipe for the roast? He didn't roast. I hope so, but we don't show him. But I just wanted to say, you know, Sister Ann Lee, you know, I've been waiting for that. Like they tell me it's going to be okay.
Amen.
But people say that, but it's so hard. I don't care what you say. You know, you have your belief, but you still, you know, want what you want. And I'm still going through it with my belief. But I just wanted to say that, you know, I'm going to miss that man, you know. And he came to church every Sunday.
And I'll be
I'm for my family being able to know my uncles and my aunties, my mother's brothers and sisters. I had the pleasure of taking care of some of them, and I wouldn't change a thing. One thing I did have a chance to do was to spend some time with Uncle Joe at the hospital. And we were reading the Bible, and I read him my two favorite verses in the Bible, chapters in the Bible. And I come to find out, I found out that he said that Psalms 102 was his favorite. And as I read that to him, he quoted it. And I did not know Uncle Joe read the Bible that much. I'd see him every now and then in his room, you know, sitting with the Bible on his bed, and he'd be sitting beside it. But I thank God for Uncle Joe. I thank God for my family, and I love each and every one of you. Rita, Cousin Rita, and Daisy, I thank you all for taking care of him. Aunt Ann, I love you. Don't think that I don't. You'll always be my family. You'll always be in my family. The rest of the family, I know some of you all. And I thank God for you all. I miss my family already.
Oh, yes. Homegoing celebration. And I just thank God that he knew Jesus is his personal Savior. Because I remember the first time I met Uncle Joe as a little girl.
Yeah.
It was during the time he had got shot and they were not looking for him to live. And I remember the turmoil and the wailing and going on in the house because this is my grandmother's brother. He's my granduncle. And just the uproar that was going on because their brother had been shot. And I was a little girl, and I didn't know what all of that meant, but I just knew the grief that went on. And when I got that opportunity to go to Billings Hospital with my grandmother and my grandfather to meet this uncle I had never met before, I had no memory of meeting him. And you would never think that he was as bad off as he was. Because when we went there, by me being a child, he met us down in the cafeteria, and he was sitting in a chair, and you would never have even thought that he had been as bad off as he was. And I just remember meeting him, and I found out who Uncle Newt was, because that was his other name, Newt. And I had a conversation with him about that. Uncle Joe, where did you get that name from? He said he didn't know. So I said, the name probably was Joseph Newton Liggins, and you just dropped the Newt. So, but I just thank God for him. I just thank God for all the times we had together. I thank God for how I was able to spend time with him and call him on the phone and talk to him on the phone. And I'll never forget something that he said, that you have to get up with a purpose. Because my uncle lived to be 99, and I'm going to go by the Jewish way of life. They count the 9 months where you were in the womb. So he was a centurion as far as I'm concerned. I wanted to see him make it to the 100th birthday, but God said otherwise. But as far as I'm concerned, he was still a centurion. He made his 100 years. And I just thank God for what he imparted in my life. I thank God that I was able to reconnect my biological dad with him again. They were friends many years ago and just went separate ways, you know, down through the years. And I just thank God that I was instrumental in bringing them back together. I thank God the time that recently I took him to lunch, reminiscing of how my sister and I took him to Salam's restaurant. And after 15, 16 years, they reopened. So he enjoyed himself and so at their buffet. And I said, well, I'm going to take him back. The buffet is enough. So I went and got him and Auntie Ann. We went there and sat down. And I'm like, well, he's a fish eater. I know he'll get the fish. I'm like, Uncle Joe, aren't you going to get the fish? I found out he didn't like the white. I said, oh, my goodness. But he did enjoy his meal. And I just thank God for that I had that opportunity to spend that time with them, to just even find out little things about him, when he was in the Navy, on the USS New Mexico battleship. Read up about it. He was on a ship that was something in World War II. Y'all need to Google search that and see what he did during World War II and how he served his country and how he worked in the kitchen. since we're going to talk about the kitchen, he worked in the kitchen on the battleship. And he shared with me, because he was an entrepreneur. All those niggas were entrepreneurs. And he told me that he cooked the meals for the officers. And he sold the chicken wings to the mates and charged them $1 a wing. Now, this is back in World War II in the 40s. And I'm like, Uncle Joe, you charge $1 for one wing? And he said, yeah. So he told me how he made money on that battleship, and that was selling chicken wings to the mates, because you're not going to serve that to the officers. But I just thank God for all the little stories he told me and things. And yet he appeared to be grumpy. I thought he was grumpy. I remember he would come to Chicago and he wouldn't give us the apples. And I was like, well, Uncle Harry always give us apples and you tell us we have to pay. He said, well, that's sister, that's not me. But we would steal the apples and run with them. Just run and run. And he didn't care. He didn't care. It was just the way he was. He just had that demeanor. But he had a heart of gold. And you just had to get to know him. And I just thank God for knowing my old Uncle Joe. And Auntie Ann, you know, we're in touch. I called you. We just had a conversation, so you don't have to worry about me keeping in touch with you. And your children don't have to worry about that, because we have our friendship. And I just thank God for all of my family for coming out, my cousins coming all the way from Michigan, my cousin from D.C. You know, I just thank God for this homegoing celebration of my old Uncle Joe. Thank God.
Thank God for Mother Ann Higgins.
Amen. My mother. She always teased me by calling me her pastor. So this morning, she's my mother. I want you to know that I love you all. And I thank God that the Lord had put Brother Joe in my life. You know, I heard a few things said about Brother Joe, that he was a mean man. But when I think of Brother Joe, I think of him as being a solid man. And Brother Joe was solid. You know, I had the pleasure of riding with him from time to time. We would go to Michigan. We would go to Indiana. And I learned so much about Joe. You know, Joe loved the Lord. Yes. That's the main thing that I've learned about him. He didn't say a whole lot. But we got a chance to talk a few times. And when I think about him, I think about the scripture. The scripture said, for to everything there is a season, time, and a purpose. In his season, he touched life of a whole lot of people. A whole lot of people can remember Joe. And Joe was a good man. The reason why I know he was a good man, because he was concerned about people. And then when you think about time, I remember one day we were riding, and Joe took me up to Michigan, and he was showing me some houses, and he said, I'm pretty sure this is where the rich people live. Then we got to talk about some trees there. He said, I remember when those trees were small, but now they were very tall. I said, Brother Joe, you've been around a long time. He sort of looked at me and laughed. He said, yeah, I've been around 97 years. And so whenever you talk about time, Brother Joe felt like he had been blessed with more time than most people have. And so he sort of had a little smile on his face when you talk about time. But when you talk about purpose, it's like he didn't just live to be filled, but he had a purpose. His purpose was to help people. The reason why I know he loved people, because a few months ago I had been very sick. And Mr. Lennon only came by the house and asked me, you know, that I wanted to go out. And he brought me over to the church. And the person that I saw in the parking lot was Brother Joe. And when I met Joe, went over there, he came to the car, and I saw tears in his eyes. He was crying. He said, Preacher, I'm so glad to see you. Joe was concerned about people. The reason why I know he was concerned about people, who would go out and talk, get wild than I he would think about certain people. He said, Sister Margaret, she wants a wild man. Other sisters were so poor. Joe wasn't all about money. Because I used to say a lot of times, Joe, man, you're not going to make your money. I don't care about money, preacher. You know? And I was surprised to hear Brother Joe say that. But I learned that he really didn't care about money as much as he cared about people. So we're going to miss Brother Joe. Amen? But we thank God for him, because he has touched the life of a lot of people. Amen. So I want the family just to be encouraged and thank God that the Lord has blessed you with a person in your life, such as Brother Joe. God bless you.
Women of Crusaders. to receive that encouraging word. And I thank all of you that ever had any relationship with him. I'm sure he had something good rather than something bad. Continue to pray for the saints. Continue to pray for us. Continue to pray for this church that he loves so very, very much. He worked so faithfully with his brother, and this church was established. And even after the brother and husband went home to be with the Lord, he still worked with our present pastor in whatever way he could. So thank God for the memory of Brother Sheldon. Pray for the family, continue to pray for you. And all of you that are visitors of the service today, we'd like to invite you to come back again. Come back and see how the Lord is blessing us and carrying us on. And above all, remember us in your prayer. God bless you. I thank you.
I adopted Grandpa immediately. I remember when I was going through college and he would always tell me, you know, keep studying hard. And I would always tell him, I said, Grandpa, I'm going to take care of you. I'm going to take care of you when I come out and I make some money. And I never forget the first time I wrote Grandpa a check. I said, Grandpa, you take a check, right? And it was his birthday. This was several years ago. So every time that his birthday was coming around, he would always tap me when I would be walking down the aisle. My baby, it's my birthday coming up. And I said, Grandpa, I'm not going to forget about you. And then I think that his birthday didn't come fast enough, so around Christmas, he would start tugging me again, like, it's Christmas coming up, baby. And I'll write him another check, and I love giving to him because I knew that he loved me, and he really loved me. I remember when my mother was pregnant, but she was so small that he would always feed her and, you know, you bring her back there and give her free food all the time. And I remember my parents telling me that, and I said, I always want to be a blessing to Grandpa because he was a blessing to my family. And I remember when I was getting married, I told Grandpa, I said, you know, I'm raised the Nigerian way. I cook everything spicy. And my husband's not going to tolerate spicy food. And I remember Grandpa, he came over here. He said, get this, I'm going to bring everything else. And we went to the kitchen next door, and he just taught me how to make biscuits, peach cobbler, chicken, everything. I made a whole day. And then I was like, Grandpa, I'm not keeping up with the recipe. He said, just put the whole thing in there. And I thank God. I mean, every Christmas, he always remembered to bring me had a jelly made for me, and brought me skillets and pots, things that I'll never, you know. I'm just thankful that I knew him. And Mother Ann, I love you. And I want you to know the same way I did, Grandpa, I'm the same way I'm going to do you. And I thank God for you, and to the family, you all are in my prayers.
Who has recipe. Praise the Lord. The Crusaders choir will now come with an A selection. Receive them at this time.
Calling for others who may have resolutions at this time, you may take the podium. To my right, resolution. Whereas, once again, God, in his infinite wisdom and mercy, has reached into our midst, releasing our dear brother, Joseph Liggins, affectionately known as Brother, Uncle, Daddy, and Papa Joe, from the labors of this life, and allowed him to make a peaceful transition while he was sleeping. And whereas Brother Joe was a member of Evangelistic Crusaders for many, many years, and will always be remembered in the hearts of those of us who knew him and loved him as one of Crusaders' best cooks ever. Seeing him sitting in front of the garage selling melons or pecans. And whereas, with great compassion and caring hearts, Pastor Larry Agu and the Evangelistic Crusaders Church family express our deepest sympathy to his loving wife, Mother Ann Liggins, the immediate family, and other relatives and friends of our beloved Brother Joe Liggins in this hour of bereavement. And Whereas the Evangelistic Crusaders Church family would like you to know that the Divine Comforter is with you always and promised never to leave nor forsake you. May it be of some consolation for you to know that we are praying for the family, for we know that our Lord and Savior answers prayer. May God bless each of you and give you strength during this hour of sadness and in the days to come. Therefore, be it resolved that this resolution shall be presented to the family and a copy placed in our church archives. Done by the order of Reverend Dr. Larry A. and Wu Pastor, humbly submitted this 8th day of February, 2014. Natalia Moore, Church Secretary. To God be the glory.
There will be victory.
There will be victory.
sanctuary will be done inside us. Think about after this as you read.
Even thinking, coming here, you know, I'm like, if words were to be said, I've got so many great, fond memories of this man. And some of them I can't tell you all, because they ain't proper for church, amen. Amen. You know, I think of Joe when I first began to meet. I met him when I first came around here. I used to drive my mother's car here. And, you know, if I was standing on the street with Joe, I found out I was safe, because Joe hung a little heavy. Y'all might not know that, amen. There's times when Joe would come up to me behind in my car, and he'd come on my driver's side, and it was my mother's car. So my mother, you know, she had weapons all around the car. So he would come to me on one side, on the driver's side, and I would pull out an ice pick. I would say, amen. Then he'd come on the other side, and my mother had a hatchet. So he thought he had me one time. He saw me in the trunk. He said, and you know how Joe talks, "Woo, I got you now, I got you." "Yeah, I got you this time, I got you." And he came up behind me, and my mother had a knife. He said, "You know, you're going to be my friend." And you know, I mean, honestly, that was Joe. You know, people said Joe was me. If you get Joe was the sweetest person. I mean, he was the sweetest person in the world, if you got to know him. And the aching of my heart, more so about Joe, is just, he was our last male link to Pastor Liggins. And when he gave me that presence, you know, Pastor Liggins was our dad in the gospel. But just knowing things about Joe, the one scripture that comes to my mind, it said, "I fought a good fight. Kept the faith. I finished my course." He stayed here. God kept him here many years, and he was a blessing to all who knew him. And Sister Ann, we just want to tell you, we're praying for you, and we love you. You know, we teased Joe that when Joe had told us that he was about to get married to Ann, and we looked at Joe, and we was like, "You going on a honeymoon?" And he looked at us, "Yeah, y'all going on a honeymoon." And if you know him, I'm going to leave it at that. Let your imagination go on with it. Amen. But we love Joe. Joe was a great cook. And Joe could, you know, he cooked some stuff. You know, this was the only block that you could come in the 90th block and you can get Jesus, you can get some shoes, and you can get some watermelon. Amen. And if you go in the kitchen, they would make you some stuff, and sometimes Pastor Liggins and Joe would get in that kitchen and they would clean out the refrigerator. And they would, I said, "What are you making?" They said, "Some whatchamacallit." And I'm like, "What's in it?" And they said, "Some of everything." And you look in it, they gave it the right name. It was whatchamacallit, but that whatchamacallit was good. So I thank God for the life of this man. And I know to be absent from the body, to be present with the Lord. God has a place for Joe, and I don't believe he charged in heaven, amen. I heard the daughter say, "You can't get nothing to eat from heaven," amen. But Joe, if he's cooking in heaven, amen, which we know, but he ain't gonna charge, amen. It's gonna be free. Jesus would have to go to Joe and say, "I paid it all," amen. We're praying for you. God bless you. Keep your head up. God bless you.
That's just humor. He was a good man. And I believe Job will probably tell you all, don't you cry at my funeral. Uh-huh. He's just that type of person. But I just thank God that I knew him. And many times going over to that kitchen was just a treat and a delight. He was a good man. And if you didn't know him, you would think he was a madman. But he had a lot of bark, but he did not fight. That's just the type of guy Joe was. And I just
thank God for this day. I said, as I always say, a homecoming service is a time where we can celebrate the life of the person who has gone on to be with the Lord. I just thank God for this pastor here, Pastor Egu, and for all of the other pastors, bishops, superintendents, and whatever. All of you are God's people. But I want you to know something, that Joe lived his life. And to me, he was other focused. And I believe that that's the way that we all should be, other focused. Because if we are focused on ourselves, we are not going to amount to very much. But when you are other focused, you will have an impact that will last forever. And I can see the people that's here today, it is saying and speaking now, that Joe's life touched somebody else's life. And he has left a legacy of love that will continue on for a long, long time. This is not the end, because he's continuing living through you and you and you.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So I thank God. I was thinking, Mother Perry, when she heard about it, she said, you know, I just got to be there because I remember those biscuits. And I love biscuits too. And when Joe cooked those biscuits and eggs and sausage and bacon, you know, a lot of times when we were in Sunday school, we were somewhat anxiously getting ready to go to the temple. And so I thank God because he really could cook and cook well. And so I thank God for him. I do want to encourage the family and let you know that God is still God. And the Bible says, thanks be to God, the Father of mercy, and the God of all comfort, who comforted us in all of our troubles, that we may be able to comfort those who are experiencing any trouble. So God is there. I sat there, and I tell you, it seemed to be an impossible task. But God was there, and he held my hand, and he will hold your hand. Amen.
God bless this family. Saying God bless you to Pastor Egu and to all the elders and all the saints of God. I see the missionary as their homegoing service. One thing about a homegoing service, our hearts may be heavy, but on the other side is a homecoming. And that side is rejoicing. It was rejoicing with Pastor Ligas and all the other saints, like my mom and my dad and so many other family members of yours. And one thing I remember Pastor Dickens always used to say at funerals, he said that as we are, Well, you probably see it when you get up here. And Sister Lydia Hanley, because your son might not remember me because I was much younger than they are. But we used to hang together a little bit, and he's looking down trying to say, what are you talking about? With the Lumpkins family and going to Reverend Dobbs Church when y'all lived on May Street there. And that's why I know them back, oh my God, back in the late, mid-60s. So it's been quite a while. But I thank God that somehow God brings things together. And when God brings things together, it's together. And I thank God that Brother Joe made it in. Aren't you glad he made it in? You know, this scripture speaks of it, and I was sitting down, that when Jesus was at the graveside of Lazarus, and Mary came to him and said, if you have been here, my brother would have not died. But Jesus said unto them, you shall see your brother again. And I know he's there with Pastor Liggins. And Mother Liggins, even though you gave him the pat on the head, Pastor Liggins is probably up there doing the same thing right now. And they all rejoicing and being with the Lord. God bless this family. And we're going to meet again ourselves to meet Brother Joe and Pastor Liggins and the rest of them. God bless you.
Together. From the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, the Lord is worthy to be praised. If this man has left any impression on your life, put your hand together and give God the glory. Ministers and elders and Grace Miss Rouster to the Liggins family. Thank God for Sister Ann. Amen. 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 We love you. And me and my family and the light of the world, we're here today to let you know that God is still good. Amen. Joe was a very tough guy. Amen. He was tough. And I appreciate his toughness. Amen. Many days we had worked together in some good weather, bad weather, but we was there together. Amen. A lot of the brothers that are here, it was at the car wash. We put a lot of time in there with Brother Joe. Amen. Joe would cook and cut up watermelon. And I had to stop eating all that stuff. It's not to start to happen, but I had to put the hold on it. Amen. Amen. But I thank God for my friend. Amen. Joe was a good man. Amen. Sometimes in services like this, it's a lot going on in your mind. Just a few weeks ago, I lost my dad. Right after that, the following week, I lost one of my cousins. And then to hear that Brother Joe had went on. But what it has done for me, it has given me a better hope to keep looking up. My direction is up. Amen. And I just want Brother Joe to let him know he's another spark plug in the engine that's going to keep me going that way. And I give God the glory. Amen. Amen. I give God the glory to his family, be encouraged. God is still God. And he sits high and he looks low. And I encourage you all to hold on to his unchanging hand. Because he says, after this, amen, there is another life. Amen. We just passing through. Amen. This is not our home. We're not here to stay. And if you didn't want to die, you should have never been born. So since we're going to leave here, we might as well get our shout on. Amen. Brother Joel, I know you're up there, but it's howdy, howdy, and never goodbye. Yeah. To the saints of the Most High God, keep looking up. Thank God and give God the glory. Amen.
Tuesday prayer. And that's where I got to know him and his wife, Susanna, man. We had many conversations. I thank God for her and for this family. And I'm not going to take the time, but we're just glad to be here. I just want to share with you. And there's a scripture in Isaiah where it says, I will carry you, I will bear you, and I will deliver you. And in that, God is saying he will do three things for you if you would allow him. If you would allow him, he will take you up in his arms. If you would allow him, he will bear you, meaning he will carry you from here to there. And if you allow him to carry you from here to there, that means I will deliver you. He will bring you from where you're at right now and take you where you never thought that you could go. Trust God. I thank God for this time. I'm looking forward to hearing the eulogy. Pray our strength, my wife as well, in the Lord. God bless you.
Everybody say, salvation, to be saved, sanctified, baptized, and filled with the precious gift of the Holy Ghost. Amen. As most of you in this room, when we heard Brother Joe's homegoing, it touched our heart deeply. He meant a lot to me, like all of you. And we are grateful that we're here to be able to say something to encourage Sister Ann and the entire family, Liggins family, great family, Mother Liggins, we love you all. We certainly thank God for the pastor of this church, Evangelist Crusaders Church of God in Christ, Dr. Larry Agu. Amen. Has done a tremendous job in carrying the work of the ministry here. We thank God for all the other men of God that's on the roster. This is history. This is legacy that we're looking at on today always. Amen. We're grateful to be a part of the legacy of this ministry. Let them know that it was Brother Joe that taught me how to wash my first car. Amen. And so he learned to wash a car like nobody else. Amen. My son right now today can clean a car. And so he wanted that to be said on today. And I'm grateful for that. Grateful for the time that Joe and I had the opportunity to cook together in the kitchen. Amen. Before Joe was in the kitchen, my mom was in the kitchen. Amen. She was the first cook of Evangelistic Crusades in the kitchen. But when Joe came, come on, somebody. Amen. He loved my mother's cooking. Amen. And he loved just being able to put dishes together with even her. But we had a men's day service, and that's when Joe and I got close. When we had our men's day service and we had a breakfast. And I asked Joe, would he make his rolls? And I would make biscuits. He said, you know how to make biscuits? I said, yeah, I make homemade biscuits, Joe. And he was excited about that and always wanted us to get together and make biscuits, and he made rolls. But not only that, we traveled down the highway in my van sometimes here, going to get cars, or I'd leave my van with him, and he'd go get his watermelon. He loved to give. Amen. I have been hearing folks say that he was a kind of cantankerous person, but he was a loving man. Amen. Now, if you got upset and you got cantankerous with him, he'd shut you down. Amen. But he really was a good man and a loving man, and I thank God for knowing him. Now I'm going to give it up on today, but we're grateful that God has gotten the glory. Somebody lift your right hand. To God be the glory for the things that he has done.
Uncle Joe. Uncle Joe. Let me say to his family. And I can appreciate what you said, Bishop Arnold. We have a homegoing and we have a homecoming. We're all expecting to be in the homecoming, every one of us. It is difficult when there is always a homegoing because somebody's leaving. I will never forget the day I left Nigeria to come to the United States. My mother came to the airport and saw me get on the plane. And it looked to her like everything she got in this world has left. As that airplane took off, and she was wondering, my son is not an airplane, and I don't know if I'm going to see him again. It's always hard to depart. I don't care how old you go on this earth. The older you are on this earth, the more marks you make to make it difficult for people to forget you when you leave. Methuselah lived to be 969 years old. He was the oldest man in the Bible. And if you were to ask Methuselah's relatives, did they want Methuselah to go? They would say, no, keep it here a little longer. But there comes a time, family, we have to just release them to the Lord because they're going to a better place. I want to give a shout out to Evangelist Rita Fannings, to Mother Georgia Leggins, to Mother Ann Leggins, Sister Daisy, Sister Noreen. Why am I calling you all? Because I was there at the last days when Joe made his transition. You all did everything possible to make sure that his exit out of this world was very comfortable. You have nothing to regret. You've done a beautiful job. Thank God for you all. And there are others that work that I didn't know. Thank God for you. I got to know Joe. You know, you, Lord Joe, is talking about saying something good about the deceased. I'm going to just say a few things about Joe, and I'm going to close it up. I got to know Joe in the kitchen. He could cook those good short ribs with nice biscuits, and I don't think I've ever eaten anything that delicious in my life. And I was just standing in the kitchen that used to be next door several years ago, in the 70s, 1970s. And I was standing there, and people lined up buying food from Joe. And some were complaining. Nobody was tipping Joe. I got so frustrated, I got so angry in my sanctified soul. Why nobody was tipping Joe? And when I got to Joe and he served me, I tipped him something that must have been 2 or 3 times the price of the meal. And he looked at me and said, "What's that?" I said, "That's your tip." He looked at me again. Ever since then, the hookup was made. And I'm sorry for you all that say you get plates from Joe, but none of your plates look like mine after that. He will pack it so much, to the point that when my wife and I were expecting our first baby, she was the one that got up and testified. We were expecting her. Joe will pack some extra and give an extra plate and say, "This is for the baby that's in the womb." I said, "Joe, the baby ain't born yet. Let the baby eat." Joe show was that good. He would be expecting me, if I haven't come to the kitchen, he would send somebody to ask me to come to the kitchen. Because when I came, I bring good tips. You all know him as, knew him as Uncle Joe. I knew him as Joe Man Joe. When he heard, but before I get through the door, I would say, Joe Man Joe. And then he would stop everything he would be doing and tell that to me, get that to me first of all. He would go, I don't know where he got one of the ones, he would save the best one for me, the fattest one, he would save it for me. He would go and get some apples, some pecans, you know, all kinds of stuff. He spoiled me. He really did. Up until, I mean, his last days when I went to the hospital, Veterans Administration Hospital, to visit with him, those were his last days. He was so glad to see me. And before I left, you know what he told me? Tell Sister Tobenna that I got some jelly for her in my house. That's Sister President Herbert Hoover, President Franklin D. Roosevelt, President Harry Truman, President Dwight Eisenhower, President John F. Kennedy, President Lyndon Johnson, President Richard Nixon, President Gerald Ford, President Jimmy Carter, President Ronald Reagan, President George H.W. Bush, President Bill Clinton, President George W. Bush, and now even President Barack Obama. Yeah. Put your hands together for God on behalf of Joe. God showed up long to satisfy us with long life. That's the president. You talk about the wars that he survived. He survived World War I. How many of you were here when they were fighting World War I? He survived it. When World War II came, he said, I'm going in for the World War II. He went in for the World War II, and he survived World War II. He survived the Korean War, the Cuban Revolution. He survived the Vietnamese War, the Persian Gulf War, the Iraq War, and yeah, even the Afghanistan War. All these wars, he lived through them, and he survived it. Put your hands together for the Lord. Not just presidents of wars. He lived through several important events in his life. He witnessed the transition in transportation from horse and buggy to automobiles. You thought it was always good, put your key, your remote starter cranking on. No, it wasn't like that. Joe witnessed that transition. He saw the Panama Canal when it was first opened during his lifetime. He saw when the car radio was invented. He lived through the Great Depression. He saw Al Capone put in jail for tax evasion. He saw the Empire State Building completed. He saw U.S. officially get the national anthem, the Star Spangled Banner, when it was officially given. He saw it. He witnessed the invention of the air conditioning system. He was there when Social Security initially started. He witnessed the founding of the United Nations, when the United Nations was put together. He saw it. He saw when the United States dropped the atomic bomb on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. He witnessed the discovery of the Dead Sea Scroll, which was very important for scriptures. He witnessed the foundation of the State of Israel, and he saw the introduction of the color television. Put your hands together again for God. We're going to be going the interment. The interment will be on Monday morning at Abraham Lincoln National Cemetery. Abraham Lincoln National Cemetery, that's for the military cemetery. Monday morning, I would like for as many of you that would like to go the last mile with Uncle Joe to please meet us at Taylor Funeral Home. Meet us at Taylor Funeral Home, 6379 Street, Chicago, Illinois. Meet us at 10 a.m. and we'll share. 9:30. Thank you. That's time correct. Meet us there at 9:30. And we want to be able to get there on time because the military, they do their things different. If you don't get there in time, you get back behind the line. And we don't want to do that. So meet us at 9:30 with the living, telephone around home. Right after the services, there will be a repast for the family in Mother Georgia, Liggins, multi-purpose annex building. That is when you leave, when you go through this first double doors, you go to the right. You don't have to go outside, you just make a right at the festival, and you will be where we have set up for repast for the family. Amen? Amen. Am I forgetting anything? All right. At this time, you are in the hands of the funeral directors.
Last night. Praise the Lord, everybody. I want to give my condolences to the Liggins family. The Liggins family has been a real blessing to me in my life. I want to give you, I'm praying for you, and know that God loves you, and so do I. My name is Michael Williams. If you need me, look me up. I'm here for you, Mother Liggins, both Mother Liggins. Y'all are in my prayers constantly. I ask that you would stay together as a family, love each other, and continue to be blessed. Amen.
To Sister Ann Liggins, who is one of my second or third great-grandmothers, and to the entire Liggins family, keep your head up. God is still yet on the throne, and he's the healer for our soul, and he said he will leave the Holy Ghost as our comforter. So I'll be praying for you and be praying for the family.
Hi, Sister Ann. I know you said, why is she standing there with Justin? Because he's a little younger than me, you know. And I just want you to know that we love you so much. And we caring and we praying for you. So you just hold your head up, okay? God is still on the throne. God bless you and may God forever keep you. That's our prayer. Amen.
Joe, we're going to miss you. I remember when I was... when I was a single man, Joe and his wife would invite me to their house, and Joe would cook that soup, and he would call me on the phone and say, Elder Nimna, come and visit us. Joe, we miss you, and I know you are in a better place. And I want you to know that we love you, and pray that the Lord would encourage your heart. God bless you.
Amen. God bless the Evangelistic Crusader family and one of the sons of Evangelistic Crusaders, Uncle Joe's great nephew. This home going, we just touched the tip of the iceberg. This could go on a couple more days. This is a celebration. And yes, he's leaving us behind is the sad part, and he's going on to glory is the great part. And we just have to take a glimpse of that, and we have to trust God with that. And sometimes the emotion, the tears, and all that's good. But we know that Joe is going on to a better place. I was with Uncle Joe at the hospital, and when I came into his room, he was reaching up and just telling God, thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And my soul was glad to see that man reach up for God and that man rejoicing in the God of his salvation. And God know how to do things. We plan things. We plan when we leave this life. But God has another agenda for all of our lives. And at the wee hours of the day, God snuck in and took him when nobody else was around. And I like that about God. And so when we're not around, when mama, daddy, and sisters and brothers leave us, God won't forsake us. And the scriptures bear out. And I'm so glad, I'm so happy that I was part of this, this homegoing service. Yes, better words for less, but this homegoing service, this great event, what I was thinking of. I'm glad that I was part of it. And it left something impressed on my spirit that one day I'm going to have to go and meet my maker. And all that Joe did, and Joe was a trailblazer for the Evangelistic Crusaders Church. He served faithful in the car wash ministry. He served faithful in the cooking ministry here. And so he set a tone for this ministry of giving and a ministry of service and doing. And we're going to miss him. But he's in a better place, and God, and he's with his family member, his mother, his sisters, his brother. And we just bless God, our Savior, and say, Lord, thank you for the life that you loaned us, Joe Liggins, for these 99 years. Wasn't just long enough, but we thank God for the time that he shared with us. Amen.
Right here. Okay, I just thank God that
I got to have a chance to have Joe in my life, and I really appreciate it. And I just thank him how he welcomed me in his home when I come over there and visit in, and how he welcomed me in his home. I just thank God for that. Even though sometimes I come over there, he say, why don't you go back home? But that's Joe. Then he started laughing. But I just thank God that I had a part of planning, a part that I had a play part. I'm sorry. I just thank God that I have a part in his life that I did play in. And I just thank God for him. And he really did live the life. And I just thank God for him. And I just thank God. Bye.
Okay. Speaking about Joe, everybody knows Joe to be the unique individual who blessed us with 99 years of his presence here on earth. He's a wonderful guy. You know, we all got good stories to tell about him. You know, wow, several good stories. First 2 weeks I met Joe, we argued every day in the car wash. First 2 weeks for every day. And you don't win an argument with Joe. He's a tough guy, you know. It's like, you don't look good, you can go home. But that's my buddy, you know, and come to find out the only reason why he argued with you, if he likes you. And then if he really likes you, then, you know, sooner or later he's going to cook something for you. So I look back, you know, it's a good friend. It's a good friend. And I'm happy that he's in a better place, y'all. All right, take care and God bless.
God bless your family. We are praying for you, and God will strengthen you. This is the Gauchers, and we love you. We appreciate you. And we know that as you leave today, we'll continue to pray for you, that God will strengthen you and give you what you need to go through these times. And I love you so much. Bye-bye.
Okay. God bless you, Mother Fannings and Mother Liggins. I just wanted to offer my deepest sympathy in our homegoing service of Brother Joe. We loved him so much. It was just so much to say about him, but all I could say is amen and ditto, because I feel like he treated me just like I was he know me all my life. And I just loved him so much, and I'm going to miss him almost as much as everybody else. But the Lord comfort you and keep you and just take care of you, and just know that he is your comforter, and at some point in time, he will heal and fill that void that Brother Joe left. God bless you all. We love you so much, and we'll continue to pray for you. God bless you. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much, Mom.